greeting Saul. I hope you've been enjoying the 146th Annual International Convention of the Theosophical Society. Coming up next, we get to receive the convention message of our international president, Mr. Timothy Boyd. He is fondly referred to by many simply as Tim, but most respectfully addressed in India and our ADYAR headquarters as Mr. President. Tim was elected unopposed for his second 7-year term as international head of the TS in April this year. And we are truly blessed to have his wisdom and dynamism at the helm of our society. Tim's biography is already on the TS ADYAR website, so I felt I need not detail it here. How he found theosophy, always an interesting question to ask a fellow member, is also described in the March and April issues of The Theosophist 2021. It is interesting, however, to look at someone's background and to trace how they came to be where they are now. I can say without a doubt that Tim was destined to be our 8th international president. It is said that when one is ready to take on higher work, someone comes into our life to lead us to the next stage of our journey. For him, this started at age 21, when he first met his future mentor, Bill Lawrence, who was a clairvoyant and who probably saw from very early on a very bright future awaiting this young man who always had a charismatic and easy smile. In 2011, Tim hosted the visit of His Holiness the Dalai Lama to Chicago. It was a momentous occasion with a Theosophical Society bringing together the leaders of 2 of the most important global spiritual movements together on the same stage. What is perhaps most impactful for Tim's becoming president happened in 2012, a year before the passing of our former international president, Mrs. Radha Bernier. She made one last visit to the US and held some very private conversations with Tim, specifically to ask him to run for international president at the next election. It was as if, even then, the torch was already starting to be passed on. And in January 2014, while awaiting the results of those elections, Joy Mills in Crotona, who was a mentor to many of today's theosophists, held both of Tim's hands in hers and gave him her blessing. 3 months later, he was elected international president. Asked about whether he had an inkling all those years as to the destiny that was awaiting him, he said, "Not really. But when you give yourself to the theosophical life, things happen. Doors open at each stage," he said. Joy had told him, "Always work for the society and watch for that open door. Once you say yes, then something else happens, and then another." In his humorous response, Tim said, "When you say yes, be ready to face the consequences." One of the initiatives Tim has taken on is the restoration of the structures at our beloved ADYAR campus. One cannot but be impressed at how beautiful and elegant the restored Blavatsky bungalow is, standing next to the famous Great Banyan Tree. The renovation efforts, according to Tim, are geared not only towards maintaining the peace and beauty of Adyar as an ashram, but also to be able to use this oasis of peace in the middle of a busy city as a meaningful and purposeful place for the service of the TS to humanity, whether that be through theosophical education for children or partnering with outside organizations whose interests are aligned with the TS. Tim's wife, Lily, of course, is a natural complement to his work at Adyar. Tim always heard Lily speaking to her twin sister in what was to him simply a foreign language. Never did he dream how important that would be to the future awaiting them both. Lily is a Singaporean American who would know she was fluent in Tamil. She then was also destined for the role she now plays in working with the Adyar staff to oversee the programs for women and children, the vocational trainings, as well as the kitchen and hospitality services at our international center. Her work is invisible to most members of the society, and the sacrifice she and her daughter Angelique make to support Tim largely go unrecognized. We owe them deep gratitude. Throughout his life, Tim's primary focus has always been on the practical aspects of theosophy. This is evident in the numerous talks he gives across the globe to various lodges, groups, and sections. The application of the wisdom teachings in our lives is what is most important to him. Thus, as we prepare to close this convention, we will hear our international president's message regarding the inner life lived amidst the outer life we all face in the world. His talk is entitled A Life Within a Life. Brothers and sisters, it is my great honor and privilege to present Mr. President Timothy Boyd.
Well, hello, friends. Very happy to be able to get together and to spend a brief period of time trying to consider some things together. Would like to focus on an aspect of our theme for this year's convention. I'd like to turn our attention in the direction of the inner life. I can tell you just from the outset that during the course of our time together, I will not be fattening you with more information. I think we're all swimming in a sea of information. It has its value, but I think we all know how and where to look for information. I think our time will be best spent if we will be able to say we've had some success in our time together, if to some degree we feel that there's some deeper connection we have been able to make with our inner life. Lao Tzu in the Tao Te Ching makes the statement that to the person who seeks knowledge, they grow more and more each day. To the person who seeks the Tao, or the way, that person grows less and less each day. Our focus today is on the growing less, and what that might mean, and how it is we might find ourselves involved in that level of pursuit. When I was very young, 7, maybe 8 years old, I met a person who was really a great, great person, a woman by the name of Eleanor Roosevelt. She was really quite well known and quite active for who she was and what she was trying to do on the world stage. She was the wife of the former President of the United States, Franklin Roosevelt, who navigated the United States through World War II and through the Great Depression. But she was a person in her own right, with her own views, and was extremely active on behalf of a variety of different causes. I was 7 or 8 years old when I met her. She didn't come to meet me, Tim. Oh, she came and she spoke to a group of us. But I remember my impression of her at that time. Oh, and it was the impression of a 7-year-old mind, which was, I felt that this was a very sweet, nice, old lady. I mean, she was, at that time, it was really just perhaps a year or a couple of years before she actually died. But it was only later that I came to really understand something of the greatness of this woman. Not just of the greatness of her ideas and her work, but of the sacrifices that were required for her to do the things that she did. I mean, she was an activist for civil rights in the United States at a time when that was unpopular. It was on the wrong side of the sentiments of the nation at that time. She stood up for women's rights. She was the first delegate from the United States to the UN, which she pushed to have this UN actually formed and founded. She was the person who chaired the committee that drafted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which incorporates a great deal of theosophical thinking. Among that, those thoughts is that people should have 4 freedoms: freedom of speech, of worship, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. Big ideas. But anyway, I didn't know any of that. And so to the 7-year-old, she was a sweet old lady. But she did say something during the time that she was there. And perhaps it's something she said elsewhere as well. But she made the statement talking about the life of the mind. Because to her, the life of the mind really was what was all important, what enabled all other things in life. And so she made the statement and talking to young people about a direction that they might want to consider for their growth, for their becoming. And so she said that there are small minds, and small minds, she said, talk about people. It's the idea that, you know, when we're at our smallest, we're just kind of picking and gossiping about others. She said, average minds talk about events, things that happen in the world. And then she said, great minds talk about ideas. So this was her hierarchy of minds. And it's, to some degree, it's useful, I think. I have known great people who like to talk about people and events as well, although they don't talk about them in malicious ways. But still, I've known great people who love a good piece of gossip. But anyway, during our time together, I think I would like for us to take a different approach. You know, not limited to ideas, certainly not to people or to events. But there is another quality of mind that I think gets less attention and that relates specifically to this idea that there is such a thing as a life within. In many respects, very different qualitatively from our normal, outwardly turned way of living. In Zen Buddhist practice, there is an expression The expression is, it talks again about the mind and the nature and the training of the mind. But what the expression says is this. It says, to the mind of the expert, there are few options. To the beginner's mind, there are many options. To the mind that is trained, that is conditioned through its expertise, through its association with certain streams of information and then knowledge, it becomes limited in the sorts of options for what it might describe as reality, even. But I think we can all go back to a time, even in our youth, of a beginner's mind, when we are open, when we are as yet unconditioned. And to that mind, to the mind that is learning something new or seeing something for the first time with fresh eyes, then the options, the possibilities are many. We could even say limitless. So for our focus, what I would really like to talk about, and hopefully we can approach it from the perspective of the, from a different perspective, is the intuition. Oh, not specifically the intuition, but an intuitive approach to something that I feel is fundamental in among all people. There is a universally shared intuition. It's not a theory per se. It's not something that has the stamp of scientific proof, but it is a universally shared deep knowing that each of us, we are a part of something more, something greater. We could call it a greater life. And that's something you can't take away from, whether it is proven scientifically or not. An inner life is something that is undeniable. All of us think. All of us feel. We see. We hear. But we hear and see and feel at different levels and in different ways, to different degrees. I mean, that's just something in a family. You have, you know, brothers, sisters, each one is seeing the world from a different perspective and responding accordingly. For some, the balance of their attention, the things that they are looking at and seeing, is rooted in the world of taste, of touch, in the material world, that is the focus. That's the place where people feel at home and make their home. But then there are others who live somehow in a different world. You know, the old expression of hear the beat of a different drummer and march to that. A different world, parallel, but a different sort of sensed experience. I mean, the whole idea of what is described as clairvoyance. And again, I have, during the course of my life, have known some people who have been deeply clairvoyant, and which is not the same as saying that they are infallible or 100% accurate, no more so than you would say that someone looking at something is infallible and saw every aspect of it. But clairvoyance literally means clear seeing. People who see much as we do, but at a different level, in a slightly different dimension. We use the same language when we talk about the inner life. Same language we use to speak about a dream. Each of us dreams, whether we remember the dreams regularly or not. We close our eyes, our consciousness retreats from its involvement in the day-to-day world, the world of the material and the senses, and we dream. And in those dreams, there is an unquestioned sense of their reality. Even there are some people who even have the habit of what is described as lucid dreaming, which is to say that they're fully awake and aware in the dream that it is a dream, and yet still participate in the unfolding story and activities that go on in this other reality. But we use the same language to describe a dream as we do when we go on a trip to the grocery store. Probably, if we were to look at it, for those people who find value in the spiritual traditions of the world, each of them has scriptures. And those scriptures use the same language we use in talking about day-to-day things to try to describe things that are so far beyond our current perception that you would think there would be no possible connection. I mean, often I'm very fond of stories from various spiritual traditions. I think it's a way of connecting us to a deeper wisdom that's unavailable in recounting of information or sharing of knowledge. There's a distinct difference between information, knowledge, understanding, wisdom. It's been said that, you know, often what we seek is knowledge. And sometimes we feel as if knowledge is the gateway to all other things. And it, while it has a deep value, it has been said, and I think rightly, that we can become knowledgeable from someone else's knowledge. But we cannot become wise from someone else's wisdom. Wisdom is of a completely different order than knowledge. Wisdom is a perception of reality that so many of the, what we would describe as spiritual teachers, have come to try to communicate to us. And again, communicating to us using the language that we speak. So you have, you know, the Bible, you have the Mahabharata, the Bhagavad Gita, all using stories, all using language to try to touch something within us, to try and lead us to some deeper consideration. In the stanzas of Dzogchen, the basis for the secret doctrine of H.P. Blavatsky, there is this statement using, you know, the language of fairy tales. You know, the eternal parent had slumbered once again for seven eternities. Excuse me. The eternal parent wrapped in her ever invisible robes had slumbered once again for seven eternities. It's a beautiful image. And it's the image that we encounter similarly in stories that we share with children. But this is an image describing something that is really, it's undescribable. It's describing a condition prior to the formation of universes, prior to the manifestation of everything that we think of as real, the eternal parent asleep, wrapped in the robes that would ultimately become the material of these future universes. But it's a language that is used to describe something that is deeply, deeply interior. Interior to the point of not even being in existence as yet. So even though we all share aspects of both of these dimensions, of the inner, of the outer, we find that our effectiveness in speaking across this divide is challenging. The divide, where that divide is perhaps different for all different people. Where does the outer life become the inner life? There's a quote from H.P. Blavatsky, which I like, which speaks to this idea. And so, you know, the question being, you know, how is it perhaps that we all can see things so differently, living in the same world? How is it that there are so many different points of view? And so she makes the statement that whatever plane our consciousness may be acting in, both we and the things belonging to that plane are, for that time, the only realities. If our mind is rooted in the world of matter and doing and things and jobs and the various things that we are faced with, while that is our focus, and that is the plane of consciousness in which we are active, that's what's real. Close your eyes, go to sleep, live in a dream, that's what's real. And also, there is the possibility, and this is what is spoken of in the spiritual traditions of the world, of through our own efforts, through our intention of shifting the gravity of our center to other planes of consciousness, to more interior. The idea of practice for most is not that we remove ourselves from the world, is not that we separate, because really that's not the thing that is a possibility for the vast majority of people in the world. But the idea that it is in fact possible to create a space that can become constant, that is constantly untroubled, and therefore open to a deeper level of consciousness, to an intuitive approach to being. There's the example in nature of the hurricane. You know, wherever there's a hurricane, wherever there is a cyclone, it is a huge organized pattern of weather. But it spins, and at its center, there's always what's called the eye of the storm. Although all around it, everything is in motion. In the case of the hurricanes and tornadoes, it's something that, to a human point of view, it's also quite destructive, the activities. But at its center, there is, when people are in the center of the storm, they look up at the sky and it's clear sky, beautiful weather, completely calm. So there is that possibility that the spiritual traditions of the world speak to. But it comes from the exposure that we give ourselves to these other ways of being, other ways of seeing, which are within each and every one of us. There is the well-known story from Plato, his image of the dwellers in the cave who have been chained in a cave and all they know is shadows. And so they have built a very structured and very real to them way of viewing shadows and interpreting them, because this is the only reality to which they are exposed. But in that story, it's really the story about the awakening or the deepening of consciousness. One of them is gradually led out of the cave to the upper world, where the sun in all of its brightness and all of its intensity can now be seen, the source of all light. And the process of adjusting to the vision of this light, this sun, is something that's described. Obviously, we're talking about dwellers in two worlds, the worlds of the intuitive mind or the spiritual mind, and then the world that is rooted on viewing and interpreting shadows. That's the experience that is the movement from what we could call an outer life toward an inner life. The two aren't separate. When he sees the sun, he's standing on the same earth that he was standing on in the cave, but it's just the different areas, locations in consciousness from which he is now seeing the world. And this is an experience that we find among people that we know. I mean, there are people who have seen a different vision of reality and then come back and have to deal with it. Anyone who has a son or a daughter or who themselves have been involved in war as a soldier or as someone who has been in the midst of that. The war ends, but that person has seen something that changes them. Their way of seeing humanity and the world shifts to another perspective, not shared by someone who has not had that experience. You have people who become parents for the first time, and the world pre-parenthood and post-parenthood is a very different, there are different demands that are placed on your way of seeing and behaving in the world. And to go back to another way, unless you choose just to throw it all behind you anyway, to go back to another way of seeing, once you've seen, you can't unsee. The best you can do is try to deny through distraction. There are people, I have known a number of people, who have had what are described as near-death experiences, in which, from a medical point of view, the body has died. But the consciousness has a life independent of the body, and it experiences a variety of things. Those people come back, and they come back changed. Their priorities are reordered. In the theosophical tradition, we think in terms of this and other spiritual traditions as well. There's the idea of initiation, that there are profound spiritual experiences of a deepening nature, where one becomes exposed and certainly for a time lives within a different dimension of being, a deeper dimension, a different reality. Shared, but unseen. But always, in all of these cases, there is an exposure to a wisdom or a knowledge. There is the absorption to some degree. And then there is the return. You can walk up the mountain, but you have to come back down. There is the expression, after the ecstasy come the dishes. the dishes that you have to wash and all the household chores. It doesn't just go away. So how do we bridge those? How do we bring them together? Always for people who have had these other levels of experience, there is great difficulty in trying to communicate it with others. There's the need to communicate, but there is difficulty for one who has not seen to be able to speak in ways where it can be received and understood. This is just the nature of consciousness. Really, we are all at various different stages of our unfoldment, and we are here in this world together. So the process for many who have seen something deeper, who have seen something deeper in terms of the unity, the undivided nature of life, and the informing power of, in Plato's example, of the sun, of the shared spiritual dimension that gives and brings all life. For those who have seen something more deeply, or seen something of a different sort of reality from the one we have become accustomed to, if fear does not arise, preventing us from delving into it more deeply, the main fear being that for some there might be the sense that what we have seen will not be acceptable to those around us, the place where we live, our normal life. Krishnamurti made the statement that it is no sign of health to be well adjusted to a profoundly sick society. Although we're not in this case necessarily talking about a society that is profoundly sick, it is no sign of health to deny the reality of something that has been a deeper level of our own experience. And everybody has had access to this dimension at some point. You know, at different phases in life, we find ourselves asking perhaps different questions. But there is no one who has not at some point, probably early in life, felt that there was something more. Felt that there was some deeper dimension that needed to be explored, that was present but somehow unavailable. Ask the question, you know, who am I? What am I here for? These are questions we all ask. But if that fear is not something that prevents us from moving more deeply into it, then out of this, very often people will develop some sort of approach to remaining in connection and deepening a connection to this inner life, inner world. Very often what we speak of in terms of study is one of the means for deepening this connection. We connect ourselves to an ever-expanding ladder of thought, we could say. We utilize the mind at that level by moving it to consider things that are perhaps beyond its reach, abstractions. And in that way, we move to the limits of mentality and again allow ourselves the opportunity of taking that next step into this world of intuitive insight, into this world of unconscious knowledge, we could say, of a perception of an undivided reality, which is the nature of intuition. As part of this approach or this practice that develops, we find the need to work to create and maintain that I in the center of the storm. that still space, so that in that space we cultivate and we experiment with quiet and with all of the benefits that can come from stilling the mind and allowing its contents to settle. The possibility of going from quiet to ever deepening states of stillness, and ultimately even of silence, where all of the clamoring of the various levels of mind and senses become quieted, where even all thoughts, all connections to the ever-demanding self, that too drops away, even if momentarily. So we attempt that on a regular basis to become quiet, ever more quiet. And ultimately, as part of this practice, there is the necessity for it to flow. It's not just a stagnant pond that we're trying to accumulate. There is the idea that everything must flow. And so for many people, the practice of service to others, conscious, compassionate activity, becomes an outlet as well as a tool in deepening our connections. So these are things that we consider for those who have seen. And all of us, regardless of our field of work or our involvement in the world, have had exposure to this inner life. And to some degree, we crave it. There is the idea, I find myself repeating this quite frequently, because I find it really a very basic principle. It is an idea from the field of nutrition, that you are what you eat, that what you feed your body is what determines its condition. You know, there's genetics, but then there's also how you deal with those genetics. So if you eat junk food, you have no reason to expect vibrant health. There are a lot of conditions that come along with that. If you eat quality food, you have the expectation that whatever sorts of even genetic disadvantages one might have, that it can, in fact, limit and suppress those and lead to some sort of vibrancy. We all have dull spots in our makeup, but we try to behave in ways that will magnify the qualities that are beneficial and limit the ones that are not. So you are what you eat. So we take on qualities of the, not just the physical foods, but part of our nutrition involves the things that we feed our eyes. What is it that we look upon? Is our world and our place disordered? Is it something that doesn't speak to beauty? These are things that we feed ourselves. We feed ourselves ideas. We feed ourselves emotions. That's what we turn the TV on for. Very often we tell ourselves we're turning it on just because we have a moment and we just want to space out, couch potato time. But all the while we are taking on images, we are taking on thoughts that are created and marketed for us. But what is it that we choose? These are choices. So in this idea of the inner world and that depth of experience, we choose to expose ourselves ever more deeply in that direction. For all of us, the greatest among us is not yet perfect. We think in terms of avatars and Buddhas and Christ as the perfection, the flowering of humanity. For those of us who are not yet at that flowering stage, we have to know that for each of us, there are blind spots. Our embrace of the inner life is as yet not perfect. But to the degree that we associate ourselves, it's no different than, I have frequently given the example of, how is it that you make a friend? We all have friends, and we weren't born with them. We developed friendships. We had meetings. There were things that we saw in people that we admired or liked, and we put ourselves in their presence. And through that process of continually putting ourselves in the presence of that which we admire, that which feeds us at our deepest levels, we become linked. You know, with a good friend, we can look at their face and know what their mood is. And with this inner life, we can associate ourselves with it in such a way that we can become transparent to it. We can become linked to it. That's just what we do. And so this is part of our habit of diet as well. Our normal living, the world of our families, our jobs, give us opportunities, circumstances, communities. It also helps to shape our temperaments. So a question arises. For those who have had some experience of a deep quiet, of a profound peace or happiness, of an altered reality from the norm of our day-to-day living, what do you do? How is it possible to make this something that becomes an actual presence in your life, in the way you work and live in the world? It's the challenge of the ages. I think probably for most of us, there is the sense that there is something we have and we need to give. I can remember I was coming of age in the United States at a time of great upheaval in many ways. There were movements of thought and activity that were going on at the time for civil rights, you know, for greater extension of human rights, for an end to war, what was called a peace movement, but very often degenerated simply into an anti-war movement, where it was a different enemy. It was the enemy was the ones who were waging war, even if it was friends and colleagues who had gone off into these battles. But there was also at that time an influx of Eastern spirituality. Teachers from India and elsewhere were suddenly arriving on the shores of the United States with a message about a different possibility for living, a different way of approach. So it was a time that was really strongly felt by many, particularly young people at the time, that we were on the cusp of a major change, that some deeper realization of peace, love, brotherhood, all of these buzzwords about things that are actually real, but our understanding was limited, but that these things were just on the horizon. So I think part of the process of living is that, you know, certainly everything seems to be immediately possible when we're fresh to this world. Because really, it's said in the poem, by trailing clouds of glory do we come from someplace else that is a different home. We come into this world set with a very different vision of what is real, and we learn how this place functions. And it functions in many ways very differently. And the movement in terms of what we might think of as movement toward these deeper states of unity in a recognized manner come slowly. And that's very hard sometimes to realize, particularly for someone who has had the experience of seeing it and knowing it in this life. So it can be frustrating. It can cause difficulties. And sometimes the option is to kind of deepen some understanding and sense of patience from a view of an ageless wisdom tradition. The idea is that this is one of many lives, which doesn't mute the fact that we are here to bring a certain reality into being, but this is yet another opportunity to do that. For many people who were involved in these various movements at that time of my youth, very many became disillusioned, became angered. For some, they felt that because these things were not coming quick enough, they needed to resort to the means of this world, so violence and its various sorts of forms to try to get things moving. Anger expressed through violence was a direction. For others, there came a certain understanding that because these things do not appear immediately does not make them less real, and a deepened commitment to compassionate service, to finding those areas of life and in the world and of livelihood where service can be done to express this unity that has yet to be realized in a global or among many people. So this is one of the options. Part of the difficulty of seeing something profound is that you can't unsee it. It cannot go away. So it's not just a matter of seeking the truth or finding the truth, but having learned what that truth is, we have to suffer that same truth. Suffering in the sense that in this world, there are some few people who have a genuine attraction to this kind of journey of, we could say, of unfoldment, who feel that it is something sufficiently worthy of effort to develop an ongoing, ever-deepening practice, a movement toward an understanding, toward a realization that then can be communicated into the world. Not everybody is or can be drawn in that direction. And it's not a matter of persuasion in the sense of the words that we say. What is real, once again, to anyone is the plane of consciousness in which they are functioning. That's the reality. To the degree that that can be shifted, that reality shifts with it. But I think there are things that are consistent. There is this sense of an exterior and an interior, an exoteric and an esoteric, an outer and an inner, that is the dual nature of an undivided existence is what we are up against from day to day. But I think in this process, there is no one who does not respond to kindness, to truthfulness, to friendship, to non-judgment. The response may not be immediate, for sure. But these are the qualities in the stories that you hear, like the fairy tales where people wander into become lost in the deep woods, and they find their way out by following a trail, in some stories, of breadcrumbs that were dropped. These are the crumbs that are indications of a deeper possibility. That it is our part to build into the fabric of the way in which we live a life. Kindness, there is no cost. Truthfulness, there is no cost. The cultivation of a sense of compassion is cost-free. In this brief time that we have here, I mean, my mother is 103 years old, which is living a quite a long time by the current standard in the world. But even that is a short time. We would hope that during the brief moment that we are here, that we would use that time well, so that it might be something that would be a benefit to others. And from the perspective of, you know, a person for whom the inner life is of value, a life lived in such a way that it can be an indication, a finger at least, pointing toward a deeper possibility. And that's a life that would be successful. Everyone, regardless of education, finance, regardless of all of the different sorts of ways that we have developed to divide and separate ourselves, everyone is here for something. And though it may be unclear to many, and for some who, even if there is a sense that there is a deeper something there, our vision of that something sometimes is not completely clear. But even if a person's vision is as simple as, I am here to be happy, which is the universal wish of every single person. We create countless ways to make unhappiness for ourselves and others in our often misguided sense of what happiness is. But we're here to be happy. And the deepest experiences of happiness are the ones which move us the most. Along with these deep senses, it seems there is a sense of peace. There is a sense of not being divided from others. There is a sense that this self that we cultivate and that everything is geared toward is not the important be-all, end-all that we have established it to be. Nothing of what we do, nothing of what we say occurs in isolation. So, for each of us, there is an inner knowing, an intuition of our universality, of our link to a greater, even all-encompassing life within which we participate. There is that common sense among all of us. It's something that encounters difficulties, because for each of us there are degrees to which we have actual experience of what that might mean, where we have seen it either through moments of deep happiness or through moments of deep stillness. For many, there is an awareness of a reality that seems in many ways to conflict with the way we live our lives in a normal way. Again, from Krishnamurti, the idea that there is such thing as a profoundly sick or distorted society, that these visions of reality do not accord with. So what do we do? There is the idea that we have shared of the requirement for a certain patience, although we are continually moving with a focus on a deeper possibility. The world around us does not necessarily move at that speed, but it does not hamper. It cannot be allowed to hamper our coming together with others who share this vision and our efforts to alleviate some of the self-induced suffering that we see in the world. So that's the activity we find ourselves engaged in, whether it's within a theosophical society where the view is that there is the possibility of forming a nucleus of a universal brotherhood of humanity, a universal kinship of the human family, or whether it is in other fields, religion, science, all of these are avenues through which this understanding of a shared world, that world can be described at ever deepening depths, but a shared world is a beginning point for all of us. There is this continuing work that needs to be done. Will this happen today? The possibility is there that as enough minds come together, as there is enough clarity of vision and shared understanding of the unity of this life we participate in, then at this moment, things can change. But if it does not, the work for us remains the same in day after day, in life after life. The pledge of the Bodhisattva is one that bears some scrutiny. That, why am I here? I am here to gain what they would describe as enlightenment. That I am here to become fully rooted in a place that recognizes that we are one. That all life is one. And based on that understanding, based on that vision, then it occurs in me in order that it might be something that might benefit all other beings. And that's the purpose of a life along this particular path. So there's a work, and it's unending. We do our part, and we are thankful for it. So I want to thank you for taking the time, and perhaps we can expand on this with some questions.
Thank you very much, Tim, for this beautiful and deeply thought-provoking talk. You certainly opened up a number of curious points that surely the audience would love to explore more with you. At this point, then, we would like to invite the audience to post any questions you may have for our president. Meanwhile, we can begin with some questions that are already here. First of all, you spoke about the importance of a beginner's mind. Can you please explain more about why it is important and how one might attain it?
Yeah. Well, thank you for the question, Elena. The idea of a beginner's mind, I think the way I shared it was with the Zen concept of the comparison between the expert's mind, which is closed, and the beginner's mind, which is open. But I think it's something that occurs across all the spiritual traditions I'm aware of. I know in the Bible, they talk about how you must become as a little child to enter into the kingdom of heaven. But it's when we talk about what is it, Oftentimes, you end up talking about how it is we can develop this, but it's something that's always present. Krishnamurti made the statement about truth, how it's a pathless land. So, truth is this land, in his way of describing it, where nothing has been disturbed. There aren't these imprints and paths that are cut into it. And then you take the other hand, where you have H.P. Blavatsky, where she said, in talking about the direction toward truth, that it is arrived at along a path that is steep and thorny and beset with all sorts of obstacles. So the beginner's mind is something that is present, but it's covered over. So part of what it is that we do, part of the idea of practice, is that the uncovering, the unconditioning from the layers and layers of ideas and cultural impositions that we've accepted and claimed, as we can root those out, then we find ourselves in a place that is childlike. Not childish, childlike, and fresh. We see through unclouded eyes. And this is part of the idea of practice and the kind of constant application in order to keep the normal currents from just overwhelming us as they do.
Thank you for that. You said that it is possible to create a space that is constantly untroubled and therefore open to the deeper layers of consciousness. So, would you speak more about how one can create this untroubled space and then bring it from moment to moment?
Yeah, sure. It's something where, again, when I find myself talking, I really have to go back and kind of check on what it is that I said so I'm not misleading. When I talk about creating a space, again, this kind of center that we could describe as this eye of the storm is not something that really needs to be created. Again, it is constantly there, and it's an aspect of our being. The problem for us is that it's not a place that we frequent very often. So we find ourselves with a great treasure inside of us, but unless we take the time to put ourselves closer to that, then we don't experience it as deeply in our lives. So part of what we end up doing is we end up with these sorts of practice where we draw closer. Rumi, I love checking in with Rumi and the other mystics who have tried to speak about these things. He has this often quoted expression that out beyond ideas of wrongdoing and right doing, there's a field. And in that field, when the soul lies down in that grass, the world is too full to talk about. That's the space that doesn't change, but that we have to, regularly try to move ourselves to live more closely to that. There are ways that we do that. And maybe we'll get a chance to talk a little bit about some of that.
Thank you for that. We have a question here. It says, how can we get closer to the wisdom with our limited body and brain?
That's the problem, really. The problem is we're always close to the wisdom, but the limitations that the questioner talks about is what stand between us and the experience. I know HPB made the statement that in order to really function from a spiritual consciousness, we had to paralyze the personality, were her words. That the personality, you know, this body with the limitations it imposes, you know, the emotions, the different levels of mind, all are filters to something that is always present. So we work through the mind on those things that are blocking us from this experience. You know, we talked about diet. You control the things you feed the body, you control the things you feed the mind. Not just control, you choose. And just like with regular foods, as you become familiar with it, you develop a taste for it. And so with high thoughts, we develop a taste for it. With acts of kindness, we develop a taste for it. And that moves us ever closer. It's a gradual process, but it's one that sort of is in the nature of being a human being. HPB, again, her description of what is a human being, it's highest spirit and lowest matter, linked by mind. So spirit in the attempt for it to function through lowest matter, it's a demanding. And so this is what we encounter with the limitations that the questioner talks about.
Thank you for that. We have two questions about being happy. You had mentioned that we are here to be happy. And so one question is, are we not born happy and free? And the other is, isn't this the justification for our actions, the reason for all the problems in the world? This desire to be happy.
Yeah, I think that could be said to be true, but probably it's based on a misunderstanding, which I think is almost universal, of what we're talking about when we talk about happiness. Every single person wants to be happy. Every animal, everything wants to be happy. The problems we run into is that with our limitations, we really do have a very different idea of how this is arrived at. You know, we base it on what our little experiences are, which basically, if you know, if I want ice cream and I get ice cream, in that moment I'm happy. So we get this idea that the satisfying of these various desires somehow results in happiness. That's what we experience. You know, you want wealth, you want this certain bride or groom, you get it. And at that moment, certainly there is the sense of happiness, but all of this changes and the mind goes to reach for the next source of happiness. So we confuse happiness with satisfaction of desire. Basically, anytime we have an experience that we could describe as being happy, it results from what could be described as the temporary absence of desire. I want the ice cream cone, I get it. That desire fades for a moment, and then I describe that as happiness. So everybody wants to be happy, but you know, what we fail to recognize, happiness is a symptom of something much deeper. It's not a goal. It's something that occurs as we develop in our understanding of ways to deal with the ever-demanding desires of self. First, you have to recognize it. And then with that recognition, then you can kind of figure how it is you can approach that. But when we recognize that the source of happiness is the momentary cessation of the push of desire, that can set us on a different course. And that's not a course that leads to you know, all of the problems in the world, because it requires a deep recognition of who I am in order for that to become active in me. And that's the cause of happiness. not just the limited experience of happiness. Happiness is a symptom of awareness.
So what then do you see as self-induced suffering is another question.
What I would see as self-induced suffering would be the normal sort of course of most people's lives. That we, whether we regard it as such or not, we make choices. I mean, we're born into certain circumstances, and some people are born in the palace and some people are born in the street. And from that point, life starts to unfold. But you have people in both circumstances who are deeply happy. You have people in both circumstances who are deeply tortured. The circumstances aren't the defining aspect of it. So, yes, you know, it's something where we can make choices, and this is what we do. Quite honestly, the people that we tend to admire the most are people who have made choices that seem to deepen some sort of understanding in spite of their circumstances. The people we talk about as having made sacrifices. You know, you look at a man like, you know, the Dalai Lama, for instance. He's, you know, a cultural icon for many of us. But he's a man who, you know, I was on hand on one occasion and somebody asked him about his lifetime of practice and its results. You know, you've been at this, you're deep, you're regarded as an incarnation of an enlightened being. So what has your practice done for you? And I was it's a very interesting response because he says, you know, I think that now I can say mostly I'm happy. Not that he's always happy and that life is always, he's at the beach, but mostly he is happy. And I think that's something that is a useful sort of indication from someone who is regarded as, you know, a highly spiritual person, that the problems don't go away, but the ways in which we respond are things that can deepen as we give awareness to it.
Thank you. Would you say that that happiness that we seek is really the one that is lasting, that is not rooted on things that are impermanent and therefore subject to the switching between happiness and suffering?
I think that's what it is. But at least as far as I can tell, I don't know that it's a space that we can inhabit continually. I think what comes from practice is that we establish a connection with that, but that the fact of all that is involved in being human necessarily pulls us this way and that. But while there is that connection, we can always trace our way back to it. I mean, when I look at just so many things, you look at the Bible again, for example, and Jesus, who is, you know, the Messiah. He is like the pinnacle of flowered human consciousness. He walks into the temple at one time and he sees people changing money and trading goods, and he loses it. And he just overturns the tables, he whips the people that are there. And, you know, we're talking about the Messiah in this case, in the Mahatma letters. One of the letters from KH talks about how a big kind of disruption came about from something that he wrote or he had written that was incomplete. And he said it occurred at a time when he was deeply tired and didn't give it the necessary focus. So even the Mahatma has the moments when he is not functioning at the level that is the Mahatma's consciousness. So how can we expect less with ourselves? We have to be a little bit more generous, I think, with ourselves. And that can help to, that can help with a lot of this, because we're going to be wrong more than we're right. But so long as we can deepen and maintain this connection with this space that's inside.
Thank you, Tim. Actually, that answer leads right next, or maybe is almost an answer to the next question. Former President, TS President George Arundale had said that we must be able to have one foot in the inner world and the other in the outer. Mm-hmm. And so the question was, is it possible to keep our consciousness in both at the same time? Or how do we do that constant switching?
Well, I think we're all relatively adept at it at this point. The awareness is what is most important. And we have to give ourselves time to fully withdraw from the outer world so that we can soak ourselves in a different level of experience. And then when we come return to our normal duties, they're infused with something else. I mean, we go to visit a friend's home and we have a happy time and we come back to some other activity that we're doing, and while we are fresh from that experience, we're infused with happiness. You know, we hear an uplifting talk, or we're in the presence of an uplifting person, we carry that upliftment with us when we go. It has a way of kind of petering out, so it has to be regularly recharged, and each of us finds a way to do that.
Thank you. We have a number of questions, and I don't know how much more time we have, but I'll try to do two more. While a meditation practice is not mentioned in your talk, it seems that it is implied that such a practice is necessary. So one of the questions was, would you please share or describe a meditation approach that you personally use for finding the deeper connections to the inner life? And of course, another follow-up question to that we received is using that to overcome the illusions of, let's say, identification with the body or with this material world.
Yeah, I've been noticing with myself that more and more these days, I use less and less the phrase meditation for what it is we do when we sit on our cushions or in our chairs. I think very often, you know, very real and deep things can be trivialized. And meditation is on the verge of getting into that territory in some quarters. I tend to speak more in terms of experimenting with quiet these days. Meditation, as I understand it, actual meditation, is when the hold and the involvement in thinking and thoughts are, when we are involved in thinking, when we are involved in the thought process, producing or examining thoughts, we're not meditating. You know, the famous expression, meditation is not what you think, is what. So when we sit, as a general rule, what we are doing is what musicians do when they sit to practice. We are practicing meditation. The musician isn't playing music when he plays the scale, he's practicing. We are practicing meditation with the idea that through this practice, we will actually reach a state of quiet, that as we continue with it, we can go even deeper to a state of stillness, and ultimately on those life-changing moments to actual silence. So in terms of an actual practice, there are innumerable ways to approach it. Let me just suggest something of a rather general nature. At least for me, you know, very often the way I might approach a session of quiet begins with something like, I guess I could describe it as reverence. So some sort of seeing or looking at something that is really sacred to me. For many people, it takes the form of a teacher or of a very, very high idea, but something that is powerful, something that is all-giving, and something to which we can look toward. And so with that as an opening setting, that has an effect, at least for me. From that, you know, there is necessarily some sense of gratefulness, of gratitude for this, even if it's this moment of exposure. For many of us, it's a gratitude for what is a cumulative lifetime that brings us to this moment where we can actually finally genuinely appreciate. So a gratitude. Out of that sense of gratitude, generally, there's something that flows that is expansive. HPB, in her diagram of meditation, the first thing she says is that first we have to try to conceive of unity by expansion in space. So this sense of expansion is something that then naturally moves toward stillness. In the presence of that which is sublime, in the presence of a recognition that is expressed in gratitude, an expansion takes place that leads to a potential for quiet, to sit in the presence of. And to the extent that, you know, we become empty in this process, you know, that the thinking about the laundry and the next thought we have to think or the talk we have to give, that those move away, then we actually have the potential to genuinely meditate, to be free from our engagement in thinking and thought. And then, of course, there is the, you know, we've got to come back. At some point, we won't come back. You know, the body will have served its purpose and we'll move on. So all of this is in many ways preparation for that moment, but also it creates this kind of constant capacity for, you know, wonder, for openness to something more to flow in and to make its presence known. And this is, at least from my perspective, this is the value of this practice in day-to-day life and in the world, answering the needs of the world.
It's actually quite beautiful, Tim. Just, I'll sneak in one last question, although there are more. And this is a little bit unrelated to your talk. Thinking about the mission of the Theosophical Society and its members, from your perspective, what will be the presence of the TS in the world in the next few years? Where will your accent be?
Yeah. The Theosophical Society exists to make it known that theosophy, that an ageless wisdom actually exists. So, you know, the idea, I think, of the founders had been that this ageless wisdom is so potent that even to the degree that it is touched, that it has effects. And we've seen that over the Theosophical Society's history. So I think the expression of a wisdom in a way that it can be touched by others is of great value. At least at ADYAR, we are making attempts in, you know, very practical ways. I mean, we have, you know, we're dealing with trying to educate. You know, we're moving into that experiment of educating young people, not in the core ideas of the theosophicals, not about the seven bodies of the human being, but about the qualities, the powers that are latent within us of kindness, of compassion, and how those things can be expressed. So an educational process that will create another generation. We don't know how that will pan out. You know, we are very fortunate in that two things have come together with the reaching into the idea of expressing compassion and really unity with the animal world that's been taking place at our animal dispensary. We work on a lot of practical ways. And I think probably for the next, you know, for the time that I'm going to be involved in the position I am, I would hope that we would be able to use the Theosophical Society at ADYAR as something of a laboratory for the reaching out to humanity, to the seasoning, the leavening of human thought. I mean, everybody knows wherever we are in the world right now, this is a very, very challenging time. And if you were to ask me, I would say that we have yet to see the challenges that we have created for ourselves in the future and near future. So it's something where a certain stability of mind is going to be a huge requirement in places around the globe. And so to the degree that this Theosophical Society, its work, and the basis for it, which is theosophy, can sink in to people or members will be the thing that will determine whether this experiment has been of value or not.
Thank you so much, Tim. Apologies to the others that we can't cover all of the questions that came in, but once again, I guess we're out of time, but I wanted to congratulate you, Tim, the staff, the convention organizers, and all of the participants for a most successful convention. It's been wonderful. I also want to thank the audience for joining us today, and to all of you, greetings for a wonderful new year ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Lena. Thank you all. Happy and prosperous new year to us all.